what we know can be. And every day we hope for what we still can see. It's up to us to be the change. And even though we all can still do more, there's so much to be thankful for. Even with our differences, there is a place we're all connected. Each of us can find each other's light.
Okay, we're going to sing a song now, and then we're going to teach that song to you. Okay, so I think I'll let you keep seated for this time. Aaron and Liz are going, well, actually, all of us will start off on Grateful, so everybody will be singing Grateful. And then Deborah is going to lead, like, the middle section there with Joy Fills My Heart, where that comes in, okay? Actually, I'll be singing at that point, too. And then, after about four times through on that, then I'm going to take over this section here and teach you. And in the meantime, you can keep singing grateful until I go, hey, and we'll sing. Today I start with gratitude, and we'll do that. Probably we'll do the whole thing with all the parts in it about eight times, and then we'll all drop out and go back to singing just grateful. Okay, so
just do
easy,
your best.
Right? Grateful. And we'll yes.
Thank you. First time.
We'll be doing that a couple more times this month. And now, if you'll stand, we'll sing our second song, We Come in Thanks.
Please be seated. In the beginning was the one presence of the undivided and unmanifest pure spirit of life, light, and love. In its generosity, it shared itself, its consciousness, and its love in the visible form of creation. We acknowledge this presence within us and as us. The creative energy of the divine feminine and masculine expressing in all our giftedness and creativity. We acknowledge this in our companion Mother Earth and in all sentient beings. This universal presence in everything we call the Christ. We light this candle as a visible reminder of the Christ presence expressing in, as, and through us in this present moment now. It is the truth. Let us own it. And good morning. I want to welcome everybody here today. If you're here for the first time and could just raise your hand real quickly so we know that you've gotten a welcome packet. Janae, back here in the back row. Okay, she's coming. She has to go find her welcome packets, but we will get you taken care of, and we welcome you and want you to know that whoever you are, and wherever you might be on your spiritual journey, you're always welcome here. We are a joyful, evolving spiritual community committed to spiritual practices, compassionate service, and living on purpose. Now let's just turn to our neighbors and say good morning, and then we'll move on. Thank you. Thank you so much. And now let's all just have a quick turnaround to that camera there and wave to our friends at home. We're so glad you're with us and look forward to seeing you in person one of these days. Today we would like to welcome the Calling Birds as our musicians and Kathy Murray as our accompanist. So thank you for us. Yay. And now as we get centered and prepare to say our five principles, you'll find these principles on the inside cover of your bulletin. And we say these together every week and remember these during the week. So take a deep breath and gently release. And together, God is good and present in all things. The holiness of God is our own true nature. I am creating my experiences by how I think. My thinking is guided by my daily affirmative prayers and affirmative actions. I follow and am sustained by these values in every way, every day, and so it is. And now as we prepare for our time of reflection and meditation, please hold the words of this meditation hymn and the one that follows quietly in your heart.
There's a presence moving softly in the quiet of my being. Softly all the time, one heart, one mind, one life, united and divine. There's a presence moving softly in the quiet of my being, calling softly.
Another breath. we settle into a moment of prayer. And in this prayer, we can call our attention to the ofrenda, the altar that we created for the Dia de los Muertos. And this is the last day we will have this up. And one last time, we get to notice the people whose lives we recalled, and we open up the very temple of our own hearts, and we allow our prayer to include all of those who have gone before us, and actually all of those who will follow us in this stream of life, this eternal life, this all always present truth of our being. It changes and manifests forms, we know, but life itself is our essence, and it is eternal. And it is present to us now. And so in that energy of life, we sink into the temple of our hearts and we allow our minds to open and we recall to mind other people who have asked for our prayers or situations that we wish to recall in prayerfulness. And for all those people or those things or those energies that we want to recall in prayer, feel free to say their names out loud now. Thomas. Yes, and we feel the energy of all these people we have mentioned. We call their very essence, the presence of the divine. That is the truth that flows in us and through us and is in them and is working through them and is the presence that is unfolding of each and every one of these people. And we can claim wholeness. We can claim well-being despite the appearance of something that is working against us. The truth of us is the divine is unflowing always for us. And for them, for the people on the altar, for people that we didn't even mention today who are there in our hearts and our unfolding energies, we pray for them too. And now from this prayerful state, I ask you to enter into a time of meditation and allowing. And so, if you will, lean back a little more into your chair. Just let the chair hold you. If you want, imagine it is God's spirit that is holding you, just embracing you and encompassing you and saying, we got this. The presence of the divine is here holding us up in our fullness. We allow our feet to feel comfortable and planted on the floor, connected to Mother Earth, connected to the energy of the very planet that supports us. And we feel our shoulders relax. Take a breath as needed. Rest your hands comfortably on your laps. And just let the tension, the energy of the morning and the busyness of getting here wash away. We sink into this present time, this present place, this present moment, this sacred moment here now. And it is good. And as we sink in, we recognize in this day of a change in time, the opening of time, the unfolding of newness and next steps and new potentialities into our life. We may not always see what's coming. There's like a mist that we are moving through, and it constantly opens. And we find divine light guides our way. Even in times where we just can't see what the right next step might be, our path, we know, is always becoming illumined. The next right step becomes available to us. And we affirm the energy of divine wisdom. Divine wisdom, that is the truth of our nature, supports us and guides us into making the next right step for the enfoldment and the presentation to the world of our very divine nature working through us, the perfect expression that God has called us forward and is living through us now. Trust and relaxed, and know that divine wisdom is there for us always. That we have the potential to choose always the next right unfoldment for our lives. And even when there seems times of uncertainty and we don't know the very next step, we don't know what's coming. Maybe there's a little anxiety about what's next. We lean back into spirit as we're leaning back into our chair. And we say, divine wisdom guides my next step. And so with the breath in, divine wisdom guides my next step. To be the full expression of my divine potential. Divine wisdom guides my next step. To be the full potential, my divine potential. And breathe in this state with me in the silence for a moment. In the silence. Breathing in, divine wisdom guides my next steps. I live into my full divine potential. Now wiggle your fingers, wiggle your toes, shrug your shoulders once. And when you're ready, come back to this now time, this now place. And be aware of the community around you praying with us.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity, we pray for your mighty hands to ease our suffering,
and all the while you hear each spoken need,
yet love us way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleep nights are what it takes. is life. Are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear, and we cry. We doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough.
All the while you hear each desperate plea,
and long that we have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? When friends betray, our greatest disappointments or the aching of this life is a revealing of a greater thirst this world can satisfy. What if trials of this life,
the rain, the storms, the darkest nights,
are your mercies in disguise?
Beautiful, beautiful. Okay, I'm just resonating with that song for a minute here. So today, you might have caught the theme for the month. Has something to do with gratitude, and we work up to Thanksgiving. And you might even notice as you came in, we have our tree is ready for new leaves. We had some springtime or some early, late summer leaves before. And on your chairs, everybody is going to need for this next first part of this talk, the clipboard or a book that's got four pieces of white paper and a leaf, a maple leaf, like late fall maple leaf, looks like something you see out here, and a pen. Does everybody have that? Does anybody not have? Okay, there's extra clipboards around. Can I grab this one? Here you go, Heather.
Yeah.
Oh, you got one? Anybody else need? One more? Someone over here needs something? Oh, Kathy. There you go.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. So. Oh, LM needs one. Is there another clipboard? Here you go, LM. You're good? Everybody's good? Back in the booth? Okay. So the first part that you need is you've got four pieces of white paper, and you get to take those home. So don't worry, don't, and please, And whatever you do, don't judge your creativity here, because that's half the fun. Okay, so get a white piece of paper ready, and this is the way it works, is get a pen, make sure your pen works, and get one piece of white paper. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you an animal, and you're going to have 5 seconds to draw it. Five. Yeah, I know. Yeah, so clearly this isn't about getting it all anatomically correct. You've got 5 seconds to draw the animal, okay? Oh, wait. Jay needs one. You ready, Jay? Okay, don't miss out. Okay, is anyone not ready? Okay, here's your first animal on a white piece of paper. And it's going to be 5 seconds. You ready? Turtle. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, stop. And now show somebody next to you your turtle. Let me see.
I forgot.
Can I borrow yours? Do I have like a circle with stubs? I'm making fun. Oh, half a turtle. Oh, a side turtle. That's good. Yeah, that's a turtle. Like the head thing. It could be a turtle or a deer or something. Yeah. Okay, so you got the idea, right? Some people I know focus on hands and some people on ears. And, you know, different people focus on different things. Well, turtles have ears, right? So his did. Or something. I'm not sure what it was. Okay, and what's cool about a turtle is that's a lot of indigenous cultures thought of the world as being on the back of a turtle. And you see a lot of great poetry, Turtle Island, and kind of the world is moving. And it's beautiful because that image of turtle is an image of Mother Earth as a living entity, this slow-moving entity where everybody's kind of living on its back, but it's alive, right? So it's kind of a fun critter that way. Okay, you ready for another one? White piece of paper. Okay, everyone's ready. Okay, ready, and giraffe. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Done. Okay, pens up. Nah. Okay, now show me your giraffe. What'd you get? Yeah.
You want it.
I'd say we're seeing a lot of brachiosauruses. Oh, it's a giraffe. You got the little spots. Let's see. The ears. Okay. I don't know if giraffes evolved exactly from dinosaurs, but I think a lot of you think they did. They look like a tyrannosaurus. Do you know in the giraffe family, of all the mammals, it's got the largest heart for its body weight. So it really is like a representative of love. And I know in nonviolent communication, Marshall Rosenberg and his tools, when he talked about NVC, always used the giraffe as an animal that represented the divine attribute of being a loving person. Oh, you didn't get, we need one more. Is this a spare one? All right. Thank you. Just in time. Okay, you owe us a turtle and a giraffe. Okay. You get to keep them, right? Okay, 10 seconds. Do both. Together. Talking. Turtles and giraffes. Okay, one more. Okay, ready? One more on the white piece of paper. Okay? And this... All right. Frog. Frog, 5, 4, 3, frog, frog. You get an extra 2 seconds. 2, 1, stop. Okay, show somebody your frog. Frog? No? Did you get a frog? No. Was that a stumper? All right. Okay, now that you're warmed up. She's done this before. So a frog is interesting because it's the symbol of transformation, one thing. And it's also the symbol of sort of, it's an animal that goes on land, it goes in water, it's growth, it can survive in lots of situations. So it's really resilient in its energy. And it's really transformational because it goes through a lot of changes and it's sort of transformation life from tadpole to frog. So it's kind of a beautiful animal that way. Okay, now you need your leaf. Now that you're warmed up and you get what we're doing. And I'm going to give you 7 seconds for this one because 7 seconds, and you can do a little bit more maybe, but it's going to be quick. And of course, you know these are going to go up on the tree in the back when we're done. So I know. Don't put your name on if you don't want. Or do it the colored side. Yeah, the colorful side. Okay, you ready? Okay, and some of them have color on both sides. Okay, here's your animal. Owl, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, done. Okay, let's see. Oh, it's good. It's a very fun. Oh, yeah. Yeah, but that's the fun. We don't. That's an owl. That's a dove or an owl or something. Yeah, that is, yeah. Okay. There's just a bunch of eyes, two big eyes. That's good. What'd you get? Oh, yeah, the ears. Oh, yeah, yeah. What'd you get?
Mine looks like a ghost.
Okay. Well, they did look like prehistoric animals that time. Okay, that's your owl. And in case, okay, so hold on to these. Oh, wait, now, and we're going to go back to the leaves in a minute. Before this talk is over, we're going to finish back with these leaves again. But before we go on, you have one more piece of white paper, right? Okay, get that one out. We're going to have one more. One more, and you've only got 5 seconds. Anybody not ready? Okay. You ready? God. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Stop. What'd you get? A heart. A what? Empty.
I know.
Empty. What is that? Oh, concentric circles.
A spiral.
A spiral, yeah. What'd you get? Circles. An infinity symbol? Yeah. A blob? You were just free forming the, yeah. Yeah. What is it? Oh, a heart, yeah. I've done God before, but it seems like the predominance was either a blank sheet, a heart in some form, an infinity symbol, or a, or a now? What is it? Oh, a sun. That could have been your turtle, too. I'm not sure. Circle with a bunch of lines. Okay, so the God one, you know, what I'll suggest is think about that one. And if you had a while to think about it and did this again, what might you put differently? Because again, it's that whole thing of the divine living in the manifestation of things, the expression of things, the divine unfolding of things, and we try to show that divine unfolding in symbols, and it's also in the silence of things. It's in the allness of the nothing, as the Tao says. And the fullness of the nothing is the entire manifest total of the nothing. Yeah, figure those out. The beautiful Tao. So I love it that some people came up with that side and some people show the manifestation side. I don't know. I wasn't looking for an answer. I was just curious. What did you come up with? So this is, and the reason we got an owl is I wanted to talk to you about this this attribute of divine wisdom. And when when the Fillmores first came up with the 12 powers and they talked about wisdom, they didn't actually call it wisdom. It's in this area right here, like your gut reaction, your intuition, your solar plexus. They called it judgment. Well, in 2022, that word judgment often has a sort of a pejorative context, right? It's like, don't judge me. You know, you're so judgmental. We just don't use that word positively. And they meant it very positively in the sense that we have this attribute of judgment, or now we call it wisdom, that allows us to see things rightly, that allows us to look at things from a different perspective and judge, if you will, choose from a perspective that's different, that if we only observe the manifest world and instead we see it from the realm of the infinite and the realm of divine attributes, and we stand into the 12 powers and we see this total capacity to come into our lives of wholeness. And so we look at a situation, we want to look at it with wholeness, and how quickly then we fall into separateness. You know, it's like, oh, I want to live in wholeness, and that's the truth of our divine nature. And then someone says something to me, and I go, oh, well, I'm separate from you. Why are you saying that? Or how could you do that? Or why would you, you know, this? And then it's like claiming, I see this thing of separateness, but how can we stand in wisdom that says, I am going to see it differently. I'm going to see it from a perspective of wholeness. And then you sang that song, what if I looked at these things that happened in my life and saw them differently? And it's a choice on how we choose to see things. There's this beautiful law, we call it law of attraction. And I know that's been run out, and there's been movies, and there's been all sorts of things. But I want to revisit that for a minute, because it's really kind of this beautiful principle that we can lean into. And we say, I am going to attract stuff. I'm going to attract circumstances. I'm going to say a certain kind of prayer for a certain kind of thing, and it's going to just show up. That's my law of attraction. That might be magic. But I don't, you know, it's like, you can try it. Good luck. Don't see that one coming about. But what we have the power to do in the law of attraction is we can attract our experience in consciousness of a situation. That is our power to live into a consciousness of perspective and then attract from that place of perspective in consciousness what else we want to happen in consciousness. And then the beautiful thing about that, which is really cool, is we go into this place of attracting in consciousness, and lo and behold, because we're living into a different perspective, a different consciousness, things in the material world start to adjust. So it's this balance. But we don't start with thinking we're going to track things on the material plane or track things that's going to make somebody else act different or have this, you know, I'm going to track you to change your mind. That's not going to happen. But I'm going to track the energy of me that says, I love you even though we disagree. Ooh. And then what happens? And that's the law of attraction. We can choose to attract the wholeness of the divine, the wisdom of God, you know, the fullness of relationship and divine love and life. We can choose that and find that we then in turn attract it back to us. And this works also on the sense of in this consciousness working in the material plane. When I was young, I used to take 2 shots a week for allergies. And granted, I lived in Iowa, which was all grass and corn, you know, so yeah. And everyone said, you have hay fever, you have hay fever, you have allergies. And so it's like, yeah, I've got it. You know, this is me and I'm going to own it, right? And then I had this beautiful, this physician who gave this very acupuncture. And he says, I'm just going to give you some energy here with some shot. Like, I got allergies. He shoot things into my fingers, you know, like little needles. And all of a sudden, I felt so much better. It was, like, amazing. And what I learned from that treatment was, now you've convinced me that there is something that's possible in consciousness, energetically, that tells me I don't have to live with this and own it as my reality anymore. And I can remember, sure, there was times after that where I would feel like, allergies are overwhelming and stuff. And then I started going to Unity, and I started learning these prayers, and I started saying, okay, the truth is that there's pollen, and look at that. There's trees, and there's cedar trees, and there's conifers, and there's grasses, and there's flowers. I love pollen. Look what it's doing. It is so powerful. It is so present. It is so out there in nature that my body goes, whoa, and reacts to it. Well, that's okay. Just don't react so much. It's okay, body. I know that this is true, that I'm a little susceptible, but in consciousness, I chose to have a different relationship with pollen. Shots, allergy meds, that's so far in the past now. Now, of course, I've always chosen to live in a place that doesn't have grass. And I turn on the filter, the HEPA filter when it's allergies. Yeah, I get it. It's still out there. And so, you know what I'm saying? It's this, I called into my consciousness that this is not my reality. Despite the fact that pollen's all over, doesn't mean that I have to fall into this state of suffering or name myself as somehow sick or other or flawed. I chose very differently, very, very simple way of doing this. But this is the power of attraction. I'm going to attract a state of well-being, and I'm going to attract a different way of understanding the play of what's going on in my world. I'm just gonna choose it different. There is a this is in the Gospel of Luke, Matthew, and Thomas, and and you see this often. And we talk about this thing called the imperial rule of the divine, or the kingdom of God, or it's called the kingdom of heaven, the God's imperial rule. Sometimes I think, we don't talk about imperial rule because we don't live in kingdoms. I don't know, England, we talk about a government. It's almost like this divine governance of all of us. Where is that and what is it? And Jesus of Nazareth, he talked about this concept of talking about, well, I'm here to tell you about the imperial rule of the divine. And his disciples, God bless them. They're like, well, when's it coming? Now imagine, they're looking at Jesus and go, when's it coming? And he's like, you're not hearing what I'm saying. It's here, When's it coming? And this is in Matthew, and this is in Luke, and in Thomas. And they said, Master, this impure rule, when is it coming? And he says, if you look for it, you won't see it. If you look for it, you won't see it, right? And he says, some people will tell you, look here. No. And some people say, it's coming, it's over here. And he said, no. He said, it is here, and it is over the entire earth. It is here, and it is over the entire earth. When people look, they don't see it. Which is interesting. It's like, I just was reading this again. People look and don't see it. Almost like that the master's chiding them. They don't see it. But maybe what he's saying is, you don't see it. It's not a matter of seeing this thing unfolding on the material plane. This whole thing of this presence of the divine that's overall isn't a matter of seeing it with physical eyes per se. It's a matter of first understanding it in consciousness and being in that place in consciousness. And I go back, some of you were here, we told the story about the farmer's market. I love this. And two people go. And one person goes and buys things and helps people and sees people and shares money and goes back and has a big feast with the food they got at the farmer's market with other families. And, and then another woman shows up at the farmer's market and goes, oh, everything's so expensive and I can't get anything and this doesn't work. And I don't even, Same exact situation. People brought a different consciousness. The law of attraction brought a different experience, because I'm going to go with gratitude, abundance, friendship, expansion, can't wait to see everybody, look at that beautiful food, look how cool that kale is, look at these apples, I'm so excited. The other person says, everything's so expensive. I can't buy enough stuff. And I just, you know, consciousness, perspective. What are we bringing to the table? What are we choosing to see, and what levels are we choosing to see at? And so Jesus is saying, it's you know, you're not seeing it, but it is a choice in consciousness to live and be within this realm of the divine, this outbreaking of you know, the kingdom, the governance, the overall of divine energies that is living throughout the world. And we can just get there in consciousness. Wayne Dyer tells this story of a lady who was, living at home, and she was elderly, and she had lost her eyesight. And so a friend of hers says, well, we're going to take you to this place. It's like a assisted living kind of place where you can get assistance and you can be helped. And so she dressed up. She put on her best outfit, and she coiffed her hair. I mean, she was just her best, brightest self. She couldn't wait to go to this new place. It was sad to leave her home of many years, but she knew she had to go where she should get some help because of her eyesight. She couldn't. It was hard for her to live alone anymore. So the fellow takes her, and she's in the waiting room, and she's sitting there, and she's waiting for her room, and someone says, well, we're going to go up and get it ready, and brings her friend upstairs. And he goes in, and he sees the carpet, and he sees the drapes and the bed and the furniture, and he goes, oh, sure, I think she really liked this. And she goes back down, and he says, I got to tell you about this the way your room is, and I want to tell you about it. She goes, no, I love it. You know, I haven't told you a thing about this room yet. How can you be loving it? And she says, my choice to be satisfied and content in this new room doesn't matter how the furniture is arranged. And it doesn't matter what the color of the drapes are. And it doesn't matter which corner the bed is in. I have come here in gratitude, and I love it. You know, and that's that old Wayne Dyer quote, you might have heard this before, when you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change. And it's a matter of perspective. It's what we attract in consciousness. It's this what we're pulling forward to know about ourselves. So here's how I want to end today. Pull out your clipboards again, if you will, and turn your leaf over to the backside where you didn't draw your very obvious owl. Sorry. I'm sure they look just like owls. But that's half the fun. So here's what we're going to do. And on the front side, we're going to show owls. But on the backside, I want to put these something we're grateful for. But before you write it, I want you to consider, all of us to consider, not something we're grateful for because clearly we're grateful for it. You know, it's like, oh, that new thing or something came into my life or this relationship or this abundance or, you know, that's an easy grateful. Don't put up an easy grateful. Kind of like your song. Dig for something that at first blush you go, why would I be grateful for that? Why would I be grateful for that? And sit with that for a minute, and then by the power of attraction, by the power of going, I am going to call a way of being to that situation from divine wisdom that's going to see beyond the obvious with my eyes. I am going to see it from a level of wholeness. I'm going to see it from a place of prosperity. I'm going to see it from a place of the fullness of life. I'm going to see it from a place of my abundance. Despite what it might look like on this level, I am going to choose to see it differently. I'm going to bless it, and I'm going to be grateful for it. Okay, so maybe do this. Close your eyes for a second. Take a breath. Where's a situation that at first blush might seem pretty challenging to you right now? Or maybe very challenging to you right now? Something that is upsetting your equipoise. Something that's leaving you feeling every day like, oh, this is too heavy, this is too hard, this is too difficult, this is too challenging, this makes me want to cry, this is just, oh. I'm sure we all can find something like that. Okay, and once you've got that, Take a breath. See it from a place of wholeness. How do we show up in that situation and bless it and be grateful for it as I express the fullness of my Christ potentiality in the world? And when you get that gratitude, write it on the back of your leaf. Helga's going to pass baskets up and down the aisles. If your leaf's not ready, you can throw it in the basket later. We'll leave them back there. But if you'd like, then we can just put them in the basket and we'll collect them. And this week we'll put them on the tree. Throw the pens into if you want, yeah, whatever. Okay. And we remember my choice to feel prosperous and abundance and feel a sense of wholeness doesn't matter how the furniture's arranged. And so it is, and so it is. So we let it be.
Thank you, Reverend Frank. And now if the ushers would please come forward again. Oh. Okay, those who haven't finished their words can put them in the baskets on the back table. Thank you. But we've reached the part of our service where we get to practice the abundance that we are. And we're always grateful for your generosity. So as you take your offering to your heart, affirm quietly to yourself, I give freely and joyfully, for God is my source, and I have abundance in all areas of my life. And together we'll say our offertory blessing. Together, divine love, through me, blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. And so it is.
Join us as we set aside a day for celebrating in a special way, to count our blessings, count them by the score, the things we have to be thankful for. Let's sing a song of gratitude. Let's sing a song of happy days. We'll sing a thank you song to you. We'll sing a song of joy and praise. Say a thank you for the air we breathe. The rainy days are making shiny leaves. The sun a beaming on the garden wall is saying, let's be thankful. Let's sing a song of gratitude. Let's sing a song of happy days. We'll sing a thank you song to you. We'll sing a song of joy and praise. Say thank you for the fields of rain. Say thank you for the falling rain. Say thank you for the chance to live in peace and harmony. Mighty hills that nearly touch the falling sky, flowing rivers with their water blue. For our home and country we are thankful to. Let's sing a song of gratitude. Let's sing a song of happy days. We'll sing a thank you song to you. We'll sing a song of joy and praise. Of praise. Of grain. Say thank you for the falling rain. Say thank you for the chance to live in peace and harmony. Let's sing a song of gratitude. Let's sing a song of happy days. We'll sing a thank you song to you. We'll sing a song of joy and praise.
So we bless these gifts with so much gratitude and let them go forward to support the mission and the ministry, Unity of Bellingham, for unity worldwide, and for peace on our earth. And so it is. Amen. Okay, just a couple announcements. The first one is, if you have a picture or an object or anything on the Dia de los Muertos ofrenda, the altar, the front piece here, after service, please feel free to take it home because we're taking this down on Monday. Okay? That's the first one. And second one is, you know it's a potluck today because it's first Sunday, which also means it's anyone who has a November birthday, please come forward. We would like to Ooh. Sing to you November birthdays. Okay. Oh, come on.
Come on.
Ah.
Yeah. All right, Joanna. Who else?
Two.
Aaron.
Oh, Ray. Jay. Yeah. Okay.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear friends. Happy birthday to you. God is blessing you now. God is blessing you now. God is blessing you. Are wonderful.
Okay. Yes, wait. Another announcement. Sorry. Yes. Do you need the mic or? You need the mic. They can't hear you without a mic. Yeah. Sorry. Yes. Well, on this, yeah. I know.
Ladies, I'm inviting you Thursday. The Women of Unity are meeting for their monthly second Thursday of the month, 11:45 potluck luncheon, and this month it's sandwiches. And myself and Kelly will provide coffee, tea, and desserts. We got lots of good desserts. So I want to invite you all to come. And so we, if you don't know who Women of Unity are, they were started in 1995 by Mary Jo and Joni, who carried the torch all of these years. And after 29 years, they came to me and Kelly and begged us, would you please take over? Oh. And so we have. And so the Women of Unity, we meet together, we empower each other, we pray, and we're fun ladies, and we share stories, and we have a good time. And our other function is to support the ministry, and we do that by fundraising. So our main fundraising has been the new EDU sale, but since that's in the archaic age, we're going to think of new ideas, because the Women of Unity have bought the chairs, we've done carpet cleaning, we've done all these things for the church. So we need women, creative ideas, we need your light, you all have a light, so come join us.
Oh, and Janae has an announcement as well.
I do. Morning, everybody. So this is our holiday season. So we all know what that means, right? Is that we give to the need of others. So our Toys for Tots will be starting next week all the way to the first Sunday of December. Also, we also provide dinners for families. So we're going to be starting that, and there will be six this year. I was asked to provide six Thanksgiving dinners. So I said, yes, we can do that. So there will be six baskets out. So Thanksgiving dinners for six families.
Do you have suggestions as to what to do?
Your basic turkey dinner, right? That's your basic. So whatever you feel that you can give for turkey dinners. Turkeys are already provided. Okay, so it's everything else, okay, the gravies, that you know, our turkey dinners, okay? So those will go on for the next couple of weeks, and then I will deliver right before Thanksgiving, okay? So Toys for Tots is happening, so, and that's going to be going on for the next 3 to 4 Sundays, or 5, okay? Just so I tell you, thanks.
And speaking of Thanksgiving, we are doing a Thanksgiving dinner here for those of us who do not have family in the area or will be alone on Thanksgiving. And there are sign-up sheets in the foyer if you're going to come and what dish you would like to bring. It's going to be a potluck. So don't just say vegetable. We want to know what vegetable. We're going to provide the turkey, the gravy, and the potatoes, right? And so sign up. We're limiting it to 25 people, so sign up now. If you can't decide, it may be too late. So we have a great time on Thanksgiving, and it's on Thanksgiving Day. So please participate in that. The dinner will be at 2 o'clock, right? Or is it at 1 o'clock? 2 o'clock. And then we'll ask you to bring your meals. Put your phone number on there, too, so we can call you and remind you of all the logistics, okay? Thank you.
Please stand for Rise Up, O My Soul.
And I'm going to be leading the response, the echo, okay?
And Deborah, too.
And Deborah, too, okay.
Rise up, O my soul. Rise up, O my soul. Show me the kingdom wherever I go. Here we go. Rise up, oh my soul. Rise up, oh my soul. Rise up, oh my soul. Let the Spirit flow. Rise up, oh my soul. To play
with the courage to play,
free my mind from yesterday.
From yesterday, what's true. Let me know what's mine to do, and help me to do it each and every day. Rise up, oh my soul, rise.
Let's make a circle and sing our piece.
I choose love.
I choose love. Thank you.
Peace in my life is growing because I choose love. Love's always present. It's what I'm made of. That can't be undone. I choose love. I choose love. Peace in my family is growing because I choose love. Let love be present. It's what we're made of.
Depart. We forgot to do our prayer of protection. My fault, I wasn't on my script. So let's just stand here where we are and say together our prayer of protection, and we do include everyone, everywhere. Together, the light of God surrounds us, the love of God enfolds us, the power of God protects us, the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. And so it is.